Welcome everyone to the Inside Java Newscast, where we cover recent developments in the OpenJDK community. I'm Nikolai Parlock, Java developer advocate at Oracle, and today we're going to talk about structured concurrency as envisioned by Project Loom, as well as JDK 18 and a few other bits and bytes. Ready? Then let's dive right in. Project Loom aims to bring lightweight user mod threads to the JVM, sometimes called fibers, although Loom settled on the term virtual threads. This promises to increase throughput for a wide variety of applications, but as it often goes, if a feature becomes better, faster, or easier by an order of magnitude, you don't just use the same way but faster, instead you start using it in new and different ways.
That is the kind of performance that actually changes how you work. It's no longer doing the same thing faster, it's allowing you to work in a completely different manner.
And that's what structured concurrency is. A paradigm for writing concurrent code that's built on low overhead threads, so let's dip our toes into it. What follows is based on an article and a Java enhancement proposal.
Java enhancement proposal.
Java enhancement proposal.
Java enhancement.
And a JDK enhancement proposal draft that Ron Pressler, lead of Project Loom, published in recent weeks. The term structured concurrency was coined by Martin Sustrick and later popularized in the blog post by Nathaniel Smith. Links to all of that in the description. Before we get into the structured part, let's shine a light on concurrency. What exactly does it mean, particularly compared to parallelism? When you have a task and decide to split that up so that multiple CPU cores can compute partial solutions in parallel to solve the task in less wall clock time, that's parallelism. When you have a number of tasks that you need to arrange in a way that solves as many of them in any given time unit as possible, that's concurrency. And these two are quite different. With parallelism, it's the algorithm, the solution that produces multiple tasks, and so you're in control over their shape and number. With concurrency, tasks emerge from the environment. They're part of the problem. Parallel tasks coordinate use of resources, say CPU time or data structures, whereas concurrent tasks compete over them, particularly I/O. Success for solving parallel tasks is mainly measured in latency. For concurrent tasks, the more interesting metric is throughput. With parallelism, threads are mostly an abstraction over CPU cores. You want to make sure there are enough threads to keep all cores busy, but there's little point in going far beyond that number. With concurrency, threads are mostly an abstraction over tasks. Ideally, you have one thread per task, so you can make progress on each of them whenever resources are available. Structured programming taught us that there's a better way to write sequential logic than with an endless sea of commands with go-tos pointing back and forth across it. An essential ingredient is that code constructs, for example a block or subroutine, should have a single entry point and clearly defined exit points. This went beyond being a mere programming pattern and seeped into languages and runtimes, for example the JVM's call stack. In a sense, typical concurrent programming is similar to unstructured programming. Splitting into concurrent subtasks and later joining them often happens in different methods or even classes, making it hard to follow the logic. While there's support for error handling, premature abortion, abandoning subtasks, etc., the composition across multiple subtasks is often ad hoc. The JVM understands none of this and sees every thread as an island of its own, which makes it tough to follow a task's progression through concurrent workflows or interpret a snapshot of a system's threads. Quoting from the JEP, the JDK's concurrency building blocks are too primitive to express these high-level relationships, and as we gain concurrency, we lose the benefits structure gives us in sequential code. So let's add some structure to our concurrency. The core principle is, when the flow of execution splits into multiple concurrent flows, they rejoin in the same code block. The first step, don't reuse threads. Instead, spin them up when you need them and shut them down after in the same block, binding their lifetime to the block's scope. Second step, interpret threads that are used in such a context as children of the thread that started them and as siblings to one another. Third step, add programming constructs that make it easy to get results, handle errors, abandon or abort threads, etc., all based on them working as a group. To add a bit more detail to each point, when I said don't reuse threads, that sounds dangerous. They're not quick to get and you don't want the number to grow uncontrolled, right? Well, that's operating system threads you're thinking about. Loom's virtual threads don't have those properties. They'll be cheap in every sense, so all is good. The second point, establishing relations between threads, has a particularly important implication for debugging and monitoring. It creates a hierarchy that encapsulates the entire computation of a task, regardless of how many subtasks and sub-subtasks and so forth it spawned. In a few years, that will be as central for debugging as call stacks and stack traces are today. On the third step, adding programming constructs, we're gonna cut it short. This is an entire big thing that we don't have time for today, but we'll definitely revisit in the future. If not as part of a newscast, then definitely in Jose's excellent JEP Café once this draft matures. That said, the draft JEP does define an API that's a gentle introduction to the concept of structured concurrency, and it's already available in the current Project Loom early access builds. If this topic interests you, read the JEP, experiment with the API, and take your real-life feedback, not API bike chats, to the Loom mailing list. Last week, the JDK 18 repository was forked from the main line and entered Rampdown Phase 1. That means the feature list is final. You can see it scroll by here in a Twitter thread that I will link in the description. From now on, only bug fixes will be made in that repo. On January 20th, this will be limited to severe bugs, and on February 10th, we'll see the first release candidate. Then there's two more weeks for critical bugs to be fixed until a final release candidate is released, but the OpenJDK contributors have gotten so good at this that the chances are fair that it will be RC1 that's going to be promoted to general availability on March 22nd. If you want to understand this process better, check out Inside Java Newscast number 6, where I go into more details on issues, repositories, and the various phases. In the last week, the JDK migration guide made the rounds. It's a brand new. It's there for you if you need to upgrade your codebase to the next Java version. Last episode, Billy told you about the basics of the simple web server that ships with JDK 18. A few days later, Julia Boes, OpenJDK developer at Oracle and co-creator of this cool little tool, published an article on Inside Java where she used the server for some nifty use cases like serving from an in-memory file system or a zip file. Check it out, as always, link in the description. And that's it for today on the Inside Java newscast. If you have any questions about what I covered in this episode, ask ahead in the comments below. And if you enjoy this kind of content, help us spread the word with a like or by sharing this video with your friends and colleagues. Have a great end of the Gregorian year if that's your preferred way of counting them, and I'll see you again in the new one. So long!